Chairman Clayton, very deserving inductees, Mr. President, representative of our sponsor, other members of the Manitoba Golf Hall of Fame, officials, and ladies and gentlemen. Thank you, Clayton, and if I say so, as one of your mentors, you've really come a long way. I first noticed Clayton back in 1987 when I was playing in the International Golf Tournament in Morden. With some of his buddies, he was laughing and making noise and misbehaving on one of the tees in front of us. I thought, who is this turkey? I knew he had too much to drink, obviously. But then I watched him hit the golf ball. He crushed it down the middle on that hole, and I quickly changed my thoughts about Clayton. Now, he's one of the finest sportscasters that we have in Manitoba, and I've been pleased to watch his excellent progress. My fondest memory of Aileen Robertson came from her performance, of course, in 1994, when, in my opinion, she capped her career by winning the Canadian Women's Amateur Championship. Terry referred to her demeanor a little bit earlier, and I still can visualize her stomping down the fairways with that great focus that she had and that look of winning determination, and she certainly showed it during that tournament. I covered Terry Hashimoto's successful career with natural admiration, but the reflection of one time really sticks out. It was in 1965 in the 25th Grey Owl Tournament at Clear Lake. Terry was the 18-hole leader. He was waiting to tee off in the final round when word came back to the first tee that a youngster named Brian Letang had just posted a superb 7-under par 29 on the front nine and had moved into obvious contention. Hash heard the news, and wow, did he respond. He blasted his drive to the edge of the first green, he two-putted for a birdie, and he was on his way to a brilliant 65 and the Grey Owl title. And that's how I remember Terry. Robbie McMillan. I'm not alone in suggesting it's a name that should be listed among the all-time greats of Manitoba golf, if not Canada. What a marvelous record that Clayton read off provincially and nationally. Small in stature and size, like the Hominicks maybe and a few others, he overcame that with precision, control, and golf savvy. Robbie gave his fans the ultimate thrill when he won the Manitoba Open on the Canadian Tour at Pine Ridge on the golf course that he loves in his last year as an amateur in 1996. Yes, I have so many wonderful golf memories. Not too many as a player, as many of you know over there. I've been a left-handed hacker since I started to play about 65 years ago. I learned my curling delivery from watching how Joanne Lindsay's first husband, Dale Snyder, came so smoothly out of the hat. I guess I wasn't too bad at that. I tried to swing a golf club the way a two-time Manitoba Junior champion, southpaw Emil Boschemann, did, and obviously I didn't copy very well. But there were some highlights that I can recall, like shooting a 69 one day at Tuxedo and a 67 on the little nine-hole course in Roland, Manitoba. I was fortunate to be able, with Frank Richardson and Roy Nordlinger, to play Golf's Paradise, the Masters course in Augusta. And I played other classic courses around the world, like Pebble Beach, St. Andrews, Sota Grande in Spain, Ballybunion in the Irish Republic, and Royal Portrush in Northern Ireland, the land of my forefathers. As a youngster, I remember creating a makeshift putting course in our backyard. Then when my brother came home from World War II, we started to play at Birkvale, the nine-hole course with sand greens on Ferry Road. Next came many years at Polo Park, Tuxedo, Kildonan, and Windsor. Then I joined Charleswood, and I played there for 20 years. and that was followed by nearly 30 years at Southwood. I initially fell in love with golf in the year 1946, when Winnipeg played host to the first major professional tournament in our history. It was the Girard Kennedy Open at Niagara, and with what was then a fair chunk of money, a $10,000 purse, it attracted the finest golfers on the PGA circuit. Sammy Snead scored a hole-in-one on Niagara's 15th hole in that week. The immortal Ben Hogan won that tournament by one stroke over Dick Metz with a par to Metz's bogey on the 72nd hole. I was in my glory when I secured Hogan's autograph when it was over. Many years later, as a sportscaster, I was blessed to meet so many others that lifted golf to its sports pinnacle. Superstars like Nicklaus, Palmer, Watson, and Ballesteros, and those on the LPGA circuit like Carol Mann, Mickey Wright, and Kathy Whitworth. There were some prima donnas that I didn't like, and a couple of Eastern Canadians that some of you shared my distaste for. But I also remember the delightful, informative interviews that I secured from Betsy King and Raymond Floyd. I saw the potential in Annika Sorenstam in 1992, her last year as an amateur, when she broke Merlene Netherfield's women's course record at Marine Drive in Vancouver. Locally, from my broadcasting days at CJOB and CBC, I can reflect on joining Eddie Dearden and Ralph Bagley, my good friends, to cover the golf scene, including many of the events that the media tends to maybe ignore these days, like the municipal tournaments at Kildonan and Windsor, the International, the Golden Falcon, and the Tamarack. Outstanding golfers like those here on the stage made our job so much easier by being approachable and highly responsive in describing how they won their tournaments and their golf championships. Over the years, I saw much to be commended in the sport of golf. I really appreciated the integrity of the game, but I also found fault at times with the game's directors and officials. I strongly condemned how the CLGA tried to circumvent their own rules to try and bump Lori Kane off the women's team for the 1992 World Team Championship. I lost a lot of respect for some of the people at that time. Too often, I guess I noted officials with the sole purpose of trying to penalize players rather than guiding them by explaining the options in the rules. In that respect, I always salute the officiating in Manitoba of Don Forsyth and Gordy Lenton, who I believe had the right approach to take to that position. Like many observers, I don't believe the interpretations that affected Dustin Johnson and Julie Inkster on the pro tours this year really helped the image of golf in the eyes of the public. Be that as it may, my association with golf continues to be truly a labor of love. My favorite event and golf course is the Grey Owl and Clear Lake, and those of us who serve on that tournament's board of directors team up and make it like a virtual fraternity. I was pleased to lend my voice to introduce the LPGA players at St. Charles last month, and if they want me at Niagara next year for the upcoming Canadian Women's Amateur, I'll be available. I've been fortunate to report on the golf achievements of the inductees on our stage tonight, and also those who preceded them into the shrine, and you heard some of them identified here tonight by Clayton. My assignments allowed me to watch the great developments of golfers like Todd Fanning and Garth Collings, and I found it awesome how Jumbo Jimmy Doyle, Joanne Lindsay, Merlene Netherfield, and June Bagley could be so proficient at all three levels of golf as juniors, amateurs, and seniors. And how about Marg, Ted, and Wilf Hominick? Yorkton gave Manitoba a great gift in sending that trio our way. Finally, I have to render a collective thank you to those responsible for this honor tonight and to those who have supported my coverage of golf over the many years. That list includes Dave Kamaski and his Golf Manitoba staff, Joyce Collier, one of golf's tireless workers, whose efforts have given stature and credibility to our shrine, the Hall of Fame Selection Committee, of course, to my cohorts Eddie and Ralph, Al McIntavish, and to all my friends and relatives and those that I play golf with, and of course my family and my wife Barbara, who usually asks me when I arrive home after golf these days, well, was it good or bad today? And usually I say, lousy. However, today I took a lesson from a notable golf instructor who is sitting at that table over there, and there is hope for the future. I think Tommy wants me to hit the ball like Eddie Dearden or something like that, and he's got me practicing already doing things like that. So maybe we can improve and cut a stroke or two of that handicap. Finally, to you, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to say I am honored, I am flattered, and I am thrilled to become a member of the Manitoba Golf Hall of Fame and Museum, and from the bottom of my heart, I truly thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, the 2010 inductees into the Manitoba Golf Hall of Fame, Terry Hashimoto, Rob McMillan, Aileen Robertson, and Bob Picken. Ladies and gentlemen, to announce before we wrap it up that the plaques are on display on the Wall of Fame in Golf Manitoba's office. Thank you so much for your attendance tonight and your support for the Manitoba Golf Hall of Fame and Museum. Please stay, visit, there is coffee, dainties, that's my favorite word, dainties, and chocolate-covered strawberries, that's my favorite phrase right there. Enjoy the rest of the evening. We'll see you in 2011 for the 9th Manitoba Golf Hall of Fame induction ceremony. Joyce Collier, thank you so much. The work you do is unbelievable for this. Ladies and gentlemen, drive safely and good night.
Thank you.